Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you this morning. I want to welcome you to our services. Welcome all of our folks that are live streaming with us who will watch our service later on. We're thankful to have you with us as well. And those of you who are visiting with us today, we're so glad to have you. And folks will be coming in. Their Sunday school class is getting dismissed over, so we'll go ahead and get started. Let me mention a few names in prayer and that we can just lift up to the Lord. John and Barbara Shimpo, neither one doing good. Barbara's particularly not doing well. We'll pray for Daniel, friend of Natalie has met, Daniel and the family who are visiting with us today. We're so glad that you guys are here, Paige and Kaylee, I think. Jim Hobart, remember Brother Jim in your prayers. Danny White, Ray McNabb, Doug Watts, Janice Johnson, continue praying for her. Ken Miracle, Rebecca Kaler, continue remember. Rebecca had surgery, is doing well, but it just takes some time sometimes to get through some of those things, you know, when we have surgeries and different things, and people who have lost loved ones, and just, I know there's unspoken requests and things, we just lift them before the Lord. I hope you've read your bulletin for the announcements that are listed there, and we invite you to be a part of all the things that we have going on here at the church. If you got any questions, always you can ask us. We'll be glad to have that. This coming Thursday, you know, is a wedding shower for Caitlin and Brian Jr., so you'll make plans for that, and we're looking forward to their wedding and celebrating that. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then our guys will take up our offering. Dear Father, I just want to thank you and praise you for today. And we pray for our country, all the things around the world. We pray for folks who are here, as well as those who are watching, and folks, Lord, who right now are just not able to come because of sickness and various things. We just ask you to give them a touch today, a blessing. Give us understanding of your word later, and as we worship you in song and through our gifts, may you be praised and glorified. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, fellas.
That was beautiful. Thank you, Suzanne. Well, I hope everyone had a blessed week this week. And it's good to see everyone. And August is almost gone. Our summer is almost over. Wow. We're low on our singers. We got a lot out today. But anyway, August is almost over. We're saying goodbye to summer and looking to see in the fall. So, we're a little low in our choir up here. Does anybody else want to come up and help? Anybody? Okay. All righty. Go ahead.
Thank you.
invite you stand as we sing this next one. Count your blessings. Who all has a blessing they can count this morning? I think we can all say that, right? Special music for us this morning.
Spoke touched and I gave you peace. Didn't I run to your rescue? Didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you just so you wouldn't fall. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I do it all again. Now she's talking to her father in a house that was once a home. She said, my bills are coming due, Lord, and 6 days is not that long. She hears a voice so soft and low. He says, I've moved like that before, and I'll do this little thing. Oh, and I'll give you so much more. Did I walk on the water, and I calmed the raging sea? I spoke to the wind, it hushed and I gave you peace. Didn't I run to your rescue? Didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you just so you wouldn't fall. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'd do it all again. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'd do it all again.
From that, like I did, then I know that the Lord just really blessed you. It's good to see each of you this morning. If you have your Bibles with you, I'd like for you to open them today to the Gospel of Matthew once again, as we have started this journey on the 8 steps to happiness. It's the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5. Verses today, we'll read verse 1 through 4, Matthew chapter 5. If you have your Bibles, the title of the message today is Blessed Are They That Mourn. Blessed are they that mourn. Matthew chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. May the Lord add the blessing to the reading of his word and grant understanding to our hearts today. You know, the way to happiness is outlined here in these first 12 verses of Matthew chapter 5. Last Sunday, we noted that the word translated blessed is also happy. And in the first beatitude, Jesus said the initial step toward happiness when he was saying, blessed are they that are poor in spirit, and poor in spirit was that of a sense of humility. If you're going to be happy, then you're going to have to find humility within your life. That was being poor in spirit. But we find a very strange statement in the second beatitude today that perhaps almost blows our minds. Jesus said, Blessed are they that mourn, M-O-U-R-N. Blessed are they that mourn, notice, for they shall be comforted. What would you think if a person said to a crying child, why are you so happy? You'd probably think, like I would think that person's crazy. Or else, they're cruel, they're just being mocking or whatever to do it. I'm sure the response, can you imagine when Jesus said this remark about a mourning, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, a person that is mourning is happy. Would you think what those disciples, different ones, because this statement doesn't seem really to add up, does it? We're having a hard time with it. It's here that we'll notice and need to be reminded in the Scriptures and to remind ourselves here in the Beatitudes that Jesus, and you have to get this, was not speaking to unbelievers. Look at verse 1 in Matthew chapter 5. Seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, when he had sat down, his disciples came unto him. What Jesus said here regarding the way to happiness is directed to Christians alone, those who are capable of experiencing life at the highest level of happiness. Listen, dear friend, if you don't know Jesus Christ, when you're in hard times within your life, you don't know how to be able to find that peace or that happiness or joy within your life. And you're saying, how can that person, when they're going through such things within their life, have this kind of happiness? As a hospice chaplain for about 4.5 years, and as a pastor of almost 48 years, and visiting with people who are going through difficulties within their life, that sometimes that I have talked and counseled with people who have come to the place to where they've got stage 4 cancer, they've got 6 months to live, they've got all these different times that are coming, they've been estranged from their families and different things, and you begin to wonder how in the midst of this, some people, granted, turn bitter, some people get sour, some people are mad, some people are blaming and accusing and all the things, but I can tell you the people that find peace in this are the people who get closer to God. Because what they do is saying that if I knew, I wished I had lived my life as I now live, because they knew time was running out. So you know what you do when you know time is short? You start making the best of every day. Say amen. Because all at once you've got a diagnosis, you've got something that has changed and impacted. And I want to say, dear friend, that God, Romans 8:28, that all things work together for good to them, notice this, for them who love the Lord. God doesn't say all things are good. He says all things will work together for good for them that love the Lord. And you'll say, well, it's not working out so good for me, and I love the Lord. You love the Lord in the way you love the Lord, but you don't love the Lord like He tells you to love the Lord. Come on now. You don't love, you know you don't. You only love Him as a convenience or something, or a bailout or a fire insurance. You want to escape the fires of hell. You love Him in that way. I love Him today, but I got something going on tomorrow. I might be here next Sunday. I don't know. There's all kinds of things that we make in this. But you see, what Jesus did, He said, if you want to be, because we need believers to be happy. That's one of the things that I have such a pet peeve with, is that in the house of God, we got more as a Christian to be thankful, excited, and happy about than anybody in the world. And you say, what is that, brother? You may be poor. The bills may be running short. There are all kinds of things. But what you have is the knowledge and the peace and the promise of knowing that when we die, we've got a better place in heaven. And you don't want to die right now because you're just not ready. You think, I haven't lived my life. I want to tell you something. I have seen people live a fuller life who have died at the age of 21 than people who have lived 85 years and not really lived a full life. They've never got past in the sense of immaturity within their spiritual walk with Christ. And they worried and fretted all their life about every little thing that was coming up and that was happening within their life. And you would think somewhere along the way, please, Lord, somewhere along the way that when somebody comes in here, and you know what that does? It just sends mixed signals to the unbelievers. It sends mixed signals to the world that says that here, yeah, they say they believe in God. They've got God, and God does all these different things, and Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And when they sing these songs, count your many blessings, name them one by one. You know, come on now. You know I'm telling the truth. Because all the time you're counting your blessings, you're thinking about your troubles. I know you because I know me. I'm thinking about my pain, so I'm aching. I can't think about blessings right now because I'm so focused upon what's going on, all the other things, that somehow I got to get moved beyond this. You know what Jesus did? He called the believers in. He sat down upon the mountain, and it says in verse 1, and his disciples came unto him. The message that he said in here in verse 4, blessed, happy, are they that mourn? Let me ask you, does this refer to persons who wander around with a dismal countenance, a downcast person whom you dread to see and you cross the street to keep and to avoid them? Do you think that is saying, here comes sister so-and-so, or you ask them, say, hey, how's it going? Well, not so good today. I'm in more pain, and I'm on this. And you say, Brother Odell, can I not name my pain? Can I not talk about and complain a little bit about my pain that I'm having to let people know? Yes, but if you're doing it every day and every time that you're just caught up in habitually of that, but you can just say, hey, I'm in this, that you can so much so get caught up into it that you forgot to count the blessings that you have in your life. You forgot what Jesus was talking about here when he was saying, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Listen, J.B. Phillips translates this verse, and I like his translation. He says, how happy are those who know what sorrow means, for they will be given courage and comfort. I really like that translation. Did you hear that? How happy are those who know what sorrow means, and they'll be given courage and comfort. There's two kinds of sorrow, dear friends. One leads to happiness, and the other leads to misery. One carries with it a blessing, and the other one, not at all. One leads to life, the other leads to death. The Apostle Paul distinguishes between these two in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 8 through 10, and we're going to look at these in a moment. But it says there in the Bible, in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 8 through 10, for though I made you sorry with a letter, I do not repent, though I did repent. For I perceive that the same epistle hath made you sorry, though it were but for a season. Now I rejoice, not that you were made sorry, but that you sorrowed to repentance. For you were made sorry after a godly sorrow or manner, that you might receive damage by us in nothing. For godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death. Do you notice that the Apostle Paul identifies two different types of sorrow here in 2 Corinthians chapter 7? One was godly sorrow, and the other is worldly sorrow. He says in verse 10, worldly sorrow brings, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret, but worldly sorrow brings death. Now, if we're to understand this beatitude, which is the second step to happiness, and to experience the happiness that is promised here, I think we need to recognize these two things today: sorrow that leads to misery and sorrow that leads to happiness. Notice with me, number one, sorrow that leads to misery. When Jesus said, blessed are they that mourn, he made a different sort of mention of mourning than what most people really experience. Too often, I think our sorrow is of the wrong kind. It's what Paul called worldly sorrow. that brings death in verse 10 in 2 Corinthians chapter 7. So you might ask, what kind of sorrow leads to misery? Okay, well, first of all, it's the sorrow that because of getting caught. Does anybody know about that kind of sorrow? In Psalms 32, verse 10, the psalmist writes, as many sorrows shall be to the wicked. I know Proverbs says the way of a transgressor is hard. You know, there's different things when we come to it. See, one of the many sorrows is the fact that we get caught. The thief who is arrested, the drug pusher who's apprehended, the student who cheats at school and gets kicked out or plagiarizes, or the husband or the wife who is unfaithful because, and so that sorrow really doesn't have any blessings because they're not sorry in a repentive state. They might say, I'll never do it again. It's like saying something to someone and saying, oh, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that, but then you'll say it again the next time. That you continue, it's a worldly sorrow. It's not a godly sorrow because you really haven't repented of that. It brings this kind of sorrow. You're just sorry that you got caught, somebody questioned you about it, or whatever. You see, if given another chance, when we look at this, because many of the prisoners within prisons today are generally repeat offenders, a high percentage. It's up in the 80s of those that are repeat offenders. They end up back in prison or back in jail because there is no true change of the heart. They say, they act, they talk and say, I'm going to do this or that. But then when it gets out into the world and then the temptations of doing the same things to do that, there's just different reasons why that there are so many repeat offenders that visits the prison systems because we say crime doesn't pay, but we don't show it that crime doesn't pay because we haven't really enforced our laws or our rules. There is a judgment that is coming that will be severe. But today, we've just tried to simply make things legal. So if we can't stop it, we'll just legalize it and let people go ahead and do it. But it doesn't make any difference what the law says, what is legal, versus the fact, like, let's say two men can get married or two women can get married, but the Bible says, no, that doesn't work. I'm going to believe the Bible. Now, I can respect the fact that, okay, that's your choice, and you can live, and you'll have to answer for that sin in your life, just like I'll have to answer the sin, because the wages of sin is death, and we're all going to have to answer for sin, are we not? No matter what that sin is. But we don't try to get people in here to say, well, look, this is my little pet sin. This is what I like to do. And would you mind okaying it if I can keep doing whatever I'm doing, whether you're robbing God, whether you're gossiping, whatever sin that's in your, whether you commit adultery, whether you do this or that, or the things that you do are threatening people, that you're angry, that you fall into sin within your life. No, God doesn't condone sin. God hates sin, but he loves the sinner. And we as believers in Christ ought to be just as Jesus and God is that we can love the sinner but hate the sin. And we need to differentiate that. Even as parents, if you've got children, even as friends, if you've got friends, that when you're talking about people getting caught up in, you see, that's the problem that people will get into, and they'll say, oh, I'm sorry. And then, but it's not a godly sorrow, it's a worldly sorrow. So, sorrow because of getting caught, that leads to misery. Secondly, sorrow because of failing in a sinful scheme. It's amazing today. Have you ever seen how many scammers are out there? Schemers. Boy, they're just ready to take advantage and to do everything in the world that they can to put the shaft to you, you know. I mean, they're just out there. It's just, the Bible warns us. It says in Psalms chapter 7, verse 15, he who digs a hole and scoops it out falls into the pit that he made. I like the New International Version on that one. It says, when you're digging a grave that you're going to fall in, you're going into your own grave, the King James, when you're digging a hole to fall into that, because this is what you're doing when you keep sinning. You're just digging that hole deeper. You just keep on doing those things, and it's going to swallow you up, dear friend. 1 Corinthians 3:19, the Bible says, God catches the wise in their craftiness. Let me give you an example of this sin, of falling into a sinful scheme. Let's say a man saw a wrecked car, and he has this wrecked car, and he decides that he'll be able to paint it and stuff, and he can fix that thing up. And the problem with the car is it's got a bent frame, but it's not too bad. And he paints the car and fixes it up, polishes it, it's running good. And people come by and look at the car, and he knows it's got a bent frame, but he doesn't tell anybody. Somebody goes, they buy the car, and they drive, they like the car, they decide to take it to a friend who's a mechanic, and he goes down and puts it up on the rack and looks at it, and the car, he notices, got a bent frame on it. And so he tells his friend takes the car back, says, I'm not going to buy that car. And so the person who sold the car, he's sorry for the fact of what he has done, that he tried to shove or to push this onto a guy to buy this car, never told him about, I forgot to mention it type thing. You know what I mean? We were trying to scheme. You know, sometimes we try to do God that way. You know, we just want to give him what little information, not realizing how that he understands. He knows our hearts. He knows us better than we know ourselves. You can't pull the wool over on God. Oh, you may do that. We can fix up and look pretty, stand in front of the mirror and get ready to come to church, put on the best that we can do and the best face and everything to come. But in here, you know, in here, it's like Jesus is saying to those Pharisees when he stood out and he looked at the whited sepulchres in the graveyard, and he says, this is what you're like. He said, you're white, you're clean on the outside, but on the inside, you're just full of dead men's bones. And unfortunately, that just is a description sometimes of where we just try to pull the wool over God's eyes or over other people and try to say that we're something that we're not actually being or living within our lives, because this is the same type of sorrow that might result from failure of destroying somebody's reputation or failure to be accepted as more than what we know ourselves to be. Because sometimes we just try to walk it through, you know, to get by and to do that. The sorrow that leads to misery also is because of the consequences that are suffered. Sorrow for consequences rather than for the sin that leads to misery. We forget about there are consequences to these things. In Acts chapter 8, verse 9 through 24, and I'll just tell you about this and really not reading to you, but it's about Simon the sorcerer thought Peter and John had magic power, more powerful than anything he had ever heard of, and he offers them money. And he says in Acts chapter 8, in the first few verses there, he says in verse 19, he's saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands, that he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said to him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought the gift of God may be purchased with money. And Peter goes on, thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. When you look at the consequences of sin, Simon the sorcerer, sometime or another, supposedly got converted to Christianity when he saw the moving of God, that here he was, this magician and stuff. But then when he got to seeing all the things in Christianity, he pretended to be something. He wanted to buy, he wanted to purchase, he wanted that power. He wanted that position. And what we understand here is then a curse was put upon him because of the fact of his being caught up into this greed and selfishness. And Peter goes on and says that, I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness and the bond of iniquity. Sin still has you bound here. This is the thing of what that happens in your life. And if we aren't careful, there is the consequences to that worldly sorrow that we have that you're going to suffer. What's it going to be? Well, if I don't understand how I can find this happiness, and when troubles comes to me, when the road is hard, when the road is tough, rough, or things get going or too much for me to bear, I get the news of all of the things. What happens is that I get angry. I start getting upset. I cause everybody else to be that way around me and things, because I am not equipped in me to be able to handle all that the world has. But I want to tell you, as a believer in Christ, the Bible says greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. that when you come to the place of understanding, surrendering all of these things and the consequences of sin and the miseries of this life, that you can have a greater hope, a better possibility in your life than anything else, that you can trust Christ and He will give you the help that you need. Simon didn't seem to be sorry for his sins when that judgment was placed upon him, and he asked Peter to pray for him that the consequences of that would not come upon him. He didn't say, "Oh, I'm sorry that I did the wrong thing." You see, that's worldly sorrow. When it comes down to it, to see the godly sorrow that brings, when we look at it to speak, this is what Jesus is speaking about. That kind of sorrow leads to misery, because the consequences that are suffered are the things that are happening in your life. And I want to say to those of you, this is the difference. Remember, Jesus is saying to the believers, to the disciples, "Blessed are you that mourn, for you will be comforted." Have you ever doubted the word of God to say, and you say, well, you know, I've mourned, but I'm not comforted. Okay. Answer your own question. What's that telling you? Think about it within your heart. Just think about that for a moment. Or like Romans 8:28, "For all things work together for good to them that love the Lord." But I love the Lord and things just aren't working good together. I mean, I'm in a mess. Think about it just for a moment. Notice it says, "For them that love the Lord." You see, what you say, when you say, "Yeah, I'm a believer, I love the Lord," there's a difference in being a church member and being a blood-washed, born-again believer in Christ. That's a good amen point. Because I think there are too many, if you're not careful, hides behind their church membership. Or how long they've come to church, they would sun school all their life and all the different things. I don't care what denomination you're in. Denominations, churches will not save you. Denominations will not save you. No preacher, no pope can save you. Only the Lord Jesus Christ can save you. The Bible says, "Whoever calls upon Him shall be saved," in Romans 10:13. So when you're at this point of understanding, say, where are you in this sense of being able to say, when Jesus says, "Blessed are they," happy are they that mourn. Because for those of us who are believers, to come to the place where we can cry out, and then we come to that peace of God that overcomes us when He embraces us. Now notice this. In contrast, the second thing, sorrow that leads to happiness. Contrasting it to that brings death, the sorrow of misery, the worldly sorrow. Paul recommends in verse 10, godly sorrow. What does it do? It brings repentance that leads to salvation. Do you see that? Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation. Notice this. This kind of sorrow is sorrow that is born out of conviction. You don't hear this word conviction much anymore. That's the thing. We do bad stuff, but we're not convicted of it. There's something wrong. The Holy Spirit is still in the world. The Holy Spirit is still here. But when we say things and we're not convicted about saying wrong things, when we do wrong things and we're not convicted by those things, then that tells you something that is wrong within your life. Because as a believer, as a Christian, that's what Jesus says. Jesus says the Holy Spirit will convict us. He brings conviction and judgment into the world. He brings that conviction into your heart. A godly sorrow leads to repentance. What does that say? Godly sorrow, that when I'm truly sorry for what I have done, then I repent of that sin. Repentance is like that 180, not a 360. Yeah, saying it turns you around. Yeah, I turn around and keep going the same direction. I'm going to fall down directly. I'm going to get dizzy. But it's that 180. I go the other way. When repentance comes in your life, godly sorrow leads you. You don't keep following that sin. You don't keep getting engaged in it. Conviction comes into your life. You don't keep doing the same thing. You don't keep saying the same thing. when you know that it's wrong in your life, that you don't do those things. This kind of sorrow is born out of conviction. In 2 Corinthians 7:8, Philip's translation again says, I can see that the letter did upset you. Now, the Apostle Paul wrote a letter to the Corinthian church. I mean, they had a stepson that was married to his stepmother or whatever, and they had tongue problems. A lot of churches have those problems, don't they? And they had all kind. They had stealing from God, and all that. There was all kinds of anger, fussing, fighting. They just had all kinds of things in the church of Corinth. They come out of this worshiping a lot of other gods and different things. Paul was away from them. Paul sent a letter. There's 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. And actually in the letters of Corinthians, it indicates that Paul wrote another letter that we don't have. And this is what he's referring to. He wrote this letter to them and he really chastised them. He raked them over the coals. And he felt a little bad about it at first. But it was what was needed. And after he'd done it, and then he was saying he was glad he did it. Listen to this. I can see the letter did upset you, though only for a time, and now I am glad I sent it. Not because I want to hurt you, but because it made you grieve for things that were wrong. You see, this is what we are missing today in our life. Is telling people, doing the right thing. Stop telling people what they want to hear. Tell them the truth in love. You see, that's what we need. That's when we come to church to worship God, that's what we need to hear. Is we need for God, the Holy Spirit, and the Bible. We need to hear the preachers preach. We need to hear what God is saying to our hearts, what I need to hear right now. You see, I may not hit on whatever it is in your life or whatever's happening. That's not my job. I'm just here to preach what God lays on my heart. And then the Holy Spirit takes and makes that application of whatever is going on in your life. The Corinthians' sorrow eventually led to happiness because it was born out of conviction. They got to feeling sorry about it. You can always tell when somebody is really sorrowful about something because they repent, they change, they turn around, they don't do it again. And you know, it really bothers. Sometimes when you say something, I mean, I'm sure you've done that. I have. Oh, maybe once anyway. 30 seconds, right? Y'all got me on my 30-second rule. Just kidding. In case you don't know, I said when I was preaching on the Ten Commandments and I have a 30-second rule, you know, it was talking about thou shalt not lie, and I was saying, well, I like to joke and kid, and I said, man, I'm having a hard time with this because I can't kid and I can't have fun. And I said, okay, Lord, I'm going to just give myself a 30-second rule here, is that when I say something that I'm teasing or something, and then I'll say, I'm just kidding, you know. Within 30 seconds, if I don't correct it within 30 seconds, you know I'm not kidding. And I'll back it up and say, no, this is the thing that we need to come to the place of understanding here in our hearts, like what they were doing, that sometimes we say things that we wish we hadn't said. Just something, don't we? Sometimes we do things we wish we hadn't done. Sometimes there's things that I've seen I wished I had not seen. Because I can't get rid of it, you know. You just can't, of all the different things. Edward Hastings interprets this beatitude in second, here in Matthew, says, blessed are they who are ashamed of themselves, of their shabbiness in character, their meanness of conduct. Pretty good interpretation of that, to say blessed are they that mourn, blessed are they who are ashamed of themselves. It brings us to that sense of tearfulness, conviction within our life, shabbiness in character, that we're not living it, we're not measuring up in conduct. See, sorrow for sin is not a symptom of a sick soul. Sorrow for sin is evidence of returning to good health. It's your coming back. You see, people who are deeply convicted of their sin will come to the Savior just as instinctively as sick people will go to the doctor, to the hospital. that when you find something within your heart and here dealing with it within your life, is that you repent, you turn toward God, and you cry out to Him. Just like if you had to go to the emergency room today or whatever, you hit this altar, you find a private place, you open your heart, you talk to the Lord right now where you're at, because you're realizing here within your heart that that's what sickness of soul brings you to, that godly sorrow and repentance. It's also sorrow that is this sorrow of happiness is sorrow that is expressed. And it will lead to happiness that will express itself in different ways. It cannot be contained. Some of the greatest times in my life is when God has broke me and just wrung me out. There was a time I asked God, I cried so much when I first surrendered to preach, I was standing there crying. I couldn't preach. I would just cry. Give the invitation. I tried to talking about, because God had done so much for me. I know who I am. I know what I've done. I know what God has done for me. And that's on a personal basis. It's not a basis of what somebody told me. It's what I experienced within my own heart. And I would just cry. And I finally complained. I said, Lord, if I'm going to preach, please take these tears away. Don't ever ask God to take your tears away. Tears are the sense of that, like a steam pot letting off the pressure. You know, when it's letting that, that's building up, it's the cleansing of the soul. And I know that when I have knelt and sometimes stand, or when my heart has been broken because of the loss of a loved one, whether it's a child or a brother or sister, a mother or father, or something else that's going on that I'm so sad about, or I've done something, I've said something that's hurt someone, or to do whatever, that you see, this godly sorrow brings me to that place of conviction. And in that conviction, it brings me to a place of expression. Because as I talk to God and bring that out and cry to Him and say, Lord, you know, I really, truly am sorry. And tears overflow. Well, I can remember a time when God took those tears away and my heart became hard. And I kid you not. It was one of the most difficult things for me, no matter what happened. When my son died, I couldn't cry. Because I had fallen with anger and into sin and different things. My heart had got hard because I was so mad, so upset, or whatever. I went through the motions of doing all the different things to do it. And, you know, that's what happens when, you see, we get into that worldly sorrow. Because it leads to death. You know what happens? You are dying physically and you are dying spiritually. You're so, it's just like drying up. You have no expression, no emotion. That it comes to that place to do it, because God created such a way. You know, when Jesus stood, Jesus, the shortest verses in the Bible is Jesus wept. That His heart was touched, that when it was coming to that place. And it's that's the strongest man in the Bible. And if Jesus can weep over something, I think we need to find the place. And when we can't weep, we need to get down on our knees and say, Lord, give me back my tears. Help me to weep over the condition of our world. Help me to weep over the condition of my husband, my wife, my children, my job, this country, of what's happening in our world. Help me, Lord, because godly sorrow brings us to that repentance and remorse and conviction, and it expresses itself. How does it do that? Confession. David said in Psalms 51, verse 3 and 4, I know my transgressions. And my sins are always before me. And against you only have I sinned and done what is this in your sight. David knew, and I know exactly what David was talking about. He says, my sin is ever before me. Nobody has to tell you. Oh, you'd like to ask, and you say, am I right? Am I wrong? Or is this saying, we like to justify ourselves. We want people. I want to tell you something. All you need to know right now is what God thinks about you. You don't need to know what anybody else thinks about you. You need to know what God thinks about you. Because that comes to the place of confession. That's what it is. And David was saying, my sin. Not Odell or somebody else's, when you're naming, not Deborah's, or if I name yours or whatever is ever before me, because that's our problem. Everybody else's sins are before us, and it makes us even madder Hello. All the different things that goes on. Say, no, you know, if you want to get right with God, you admit and start looking and saying, it's my sins. And if you can't think of any, I'm not encouraging you to ask somebody that might help and tell you. If you can't think of any, you already got one that you can name right now, pride and denial. Because confession, as they say, is good for the soul. But also the result of that is a changed life. When you confess, it changes your life. In 2 Corinthians 7:10, Phillips' translation says, the sorrow which God uses means it is a change of heart that leads to confession. People who are really changed, they suddenly come up against something that opens their eyes to what sin is and what sin does and says, Lord, I know what this is. It doesn't mean that you might not sin again. But once you've experienced this in godly sorrow, it will drive you back to that. And then you'll understand what Jesus said. It is a sorrow that is blessed. Blessed are they that mourn. This word has a dual meaning. It means blessed and happy. Four blessings result from sorrow that leads to happiness. Forgiveness of sin, restoration of fellowship, strengthening of character, and you know what else? It brings God's comfort. It helps us. In the early 1900s, on the Pennsylvania Railroad, there were two trains that collided, killing a lot of people, killed one of the engineers on the train, but the other engineer survived. The president of the Pennsylvania Railroad, Mr. Atterbury, asked to meet with the engineer who had survived. After several months, they found out the engineer just about was concerned taking his own life. He got into a psychotic mental state because it was his fault for the collision on the train. And he was committed, he had a hard time with his family, emotionally, mentally, all the things. He wouldn't talk, he wouldn't speak, he just withdrew. Mr. Atterbury, the president of the Pennsylvania Railroad, asked to meet with the engineer. And after a while, coming to the engineer, the man met with the Mr. Atterbury, and Mr. Atterbury walked over to him, and he put his arms around him, and he said, oh, man, we've had a streak of bad luck, haven't we? And the story says, for some time, the president of Pennsylvania Railroad and the engineer embraced each other and stood there weeping. Then Mr. Atterbury made this statement. One thing I want you to remember, he told the engineer. As long as you work for us, in that whenever any employee works for Pennsylvania Railroad is in trouble, I'm in trouble too. It said that soon the engineer began to speak and to think clearly because his boss cared enough to grieve with him, and he was healed. Because somebody reached out and empathized to care and to embrace, to care for him. You know, there's a lot of fault finders all around us who are on the prowl to heap guilt and blame on other people. But you and I can join the blessed minority who care and who are willing to mourn even when there are those who are wanting to blame. Jesus says, when we become such mourners, that we will both be comforted and we will comfort. That we will allow God to work within our lives to help us to reach and to embrace others so that when blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Pray with me. Thank you, Father, for your presence here today. And as you have spoken to our hearts, Help us, to Lord, to take in those words that Jesus gave to the believers there on the mountainside in that day, to know that one of the ways to happiness is to find the happiness that comes in whatever circumstances that is brought within our lives, because there is nothing beyond your control. And we thank you for your comfort today in your word and in your name. Amen. Would you stand with me, please, as Deborah comes and our pianist come and we sing our invitation this morning? As God speaks to your heart, I'd like to invite you to respond to him. If it's to give your life to Jesus today, to really understand, because remember, an unbeliever can't really experience this happiness that Jesus is talking about when you mourn or when you weep or when you're crying, when you're reaching out. So do that little gauge in your life there to see that when you're at this point, that if you aren't comforted because of those tears within your life, to say, then it's really asking the question, are you a believer? Are all things possible with him? That's what he says. All things are possible with him that believes, that trusts in Jesus. So let him comfort you today. And if you need to step out to give your life to Christ, to rededicate your life, to join this fellowship, to pray around this altar, whatever God is saying, you follow him. Let's sing. You're in the back of the church, the front, the middle. What do you need to do today to respond to what God is saying to your heart? Come on. You're in the middle, the back, wherever you are. Somebody will step back and let you come.
There's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
On this next verse, it'll be the last verse unless someone comes. So quickly, as God is speaking to your heart,
smile.
I want to thank you for your attentiveness. Thank you for being here today. It's been a good day to be in the house of the Lord, hasn't it? It's been a good day, and we're so glad that you're here. And if you're visiting, please come back. Come back and be with us. We're glad to have you. And we just want to follow the Lord. Let the Lord have his way in our life day by day. Well, you read the announcements of things that were listed up there. Don't forget the shower. Be praying for Caitlin and Brian Jr. for their wedding coming up in October, and for the wedding shower on Thursday night. Also, Wednesday night, remember, we've got Fireside Chat. Our youth is at 6:30, and then back here at Fireside Chat, you can ask any questions that you have on your heart. We take them and field them all. Politics, religion, Bible, whatever, we'll give you a Bible answer as we have a good time together here for Fireside Chat on Wednesday night. All right, Miss Deborah.
Okay. Sanctuary. everybody. Go out and have a great week and a blessed week. And we'll see you Wednesday night for Fireside Chat. Oh, okay. Okay, choir practice 5:45, Wednesday night.